talk to leaders. We don't shy away from difficult conversations.
ANC Leadership Series.
We don't just tell stories. We tell you why they matter. We sift through the noise and arm you with facts.
We report about disruption and how the latest technology and innovation have changed the way we live.
We told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
The Philippines.
And we are ANC.
Hello everyone, I'm Michelle Long. It's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 12 noon in Sydney. The headlines: a surge in Treasury yields dragging Wall Street, Asian shares bracing for a sell-off this morning. Here at home, the PSE Index now on a four-day winning streak. Will the vaccine euphoria continue or will there be profit-taking? Victor Limlingan of Regina Capital joins us for a market outlook. We'll also speak with ING Bank's Asia-Pacific Chief Economist Rob Carnell for the vaccination's broader impact on the Philippine economy. COVID-19 cases in the Philippines reach 582,000. Worldwide infections rise to 115 million. And the U.S. State Department calls China its biggest geopolitical test in the 21st century. Begin with the financial markets. Wall Street ending lower overnight, with the Nasdaq taking the biggest hit as investors sold high-flying tech shares and pivoted to sectors viewed as likely to benefit from an economic rebound. The tech-heavy Nasdaq dropping 2.7% as Amazon, Apple, Microsoft, and Alphabet all fell more than 2% each. The S&P 500 sliding 1.3% to 38.19, while the Dow lost 121 points. The drop came as the 10-year Treasury yield climbed to a high of 1.49% before retreating slightly. The rise in bonds continues to raise concerns about equity valuations and a pickup in inflation. Meanwhile, growing optimism over the vaccine rollout after U.S. President Joe Biden said there will be enough supply for all adults in the country by the end of May sparked a rally in cyclical stocks. On the data front, private companies added 117,000 new jobs in February.
The theme continues once again to be fixed income. You saw the spike earlier today. We missed a little bit on that ADP number this morning. The beige book just came out, I saw, and manufacturing increased in most areas of the country, which is a very good sign overall. But we continue to get these mixed numbers overall. And I think that, you know, the bond spike, along with the fact that it looks like on the stimulus bill to pass, we're going to have to cut it back even a little bit more overall.
The 117,000 new jobs added in February came in at a weaker than expected pace. Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, all of them poised to still feel the pressure when they do open tonight. Manila time, with the tech-heavy Nasdaq still leading the pack, down by about half of 1%. Over here in Asia, shares falling at the open following that overnight drop on Wall Street as bond yields are on the rise again. Markets in Japan, South Korea, and Australia all down by 1% each, dragged mostly by tech shares. We're just going to have to change the green arrows to red arrows pointing downwards. The Japanese yen also hitting a seven-month high, rather seven-month low, at 107 yen to the dollar as economic recovery hopes in the U.S. lifted the greenback. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken says China is the biggest geopolitical test for the U.S. in the 21st century. In his first major speech, Blinken sought to set out how foreign policy will bring benefits for American workers and families. He then enumerated eight priorities, which includes dealing with China, saying it is the only country with enough power to jeopardize international order.
But the challenge posed by China is different. China is the only country with the economic, diplomatic, military, and technological power to seriously challenge the stable and open international system. Our relationship with China will be competitive when it should be, collaborative when it can be, and adversarial when it must be. The common denominator is the need to engage China from a position of strength. That requires working with allies and partners, not denigrating them, because our combined weight is much harder for China to ignore.
The Biden administration wants to signal a break with former President Donald Trump's America First approach by re-engaging with allies. Other priorities of the State Department include working to avoid another pandemic, tackling climate change, creating a more humane immigration system, and promoting democracy abroad. Britain delivers what it hopes to be its last big spending splurge to get the country's economy through the COVID-19 pandemic. British Finance Minister Rishi Sunak announced tens of billions of pounds in additional aid on Wednesday to see workers and businesses through the summer and the vaccine rollout. The measures include a five-month extension of the UK's huge jobs rescue plan, the continuation of an emergency increase in welfare payments, as well as the property tax exemption for retail, hospitality, and leisure businesses. But Sunak also laid out a plan to raise taxes once the pandemic is expected to be over to replenish public finances. The British economy shrank 9.9% last year, its biggest decline in over 300 years, due to the pandemic. Disney will close at least 60 stores in North America this year as it turns its focus to e-commerce. A spokesperson also says the company is evaluating a significant reduction in physical stores in Europe. But the company did not say how many people would lose their jobs as a result of its store closures. Disney has been revamping its digital shopping platforms as more people go online amid the pandemic. Digital shopping gives Disney a chance to offer a broader selection and include higher-end products from all of its Disney, Pixar, Marvel, and Star Wars brands. Now, here are some economic events we're monitoring today, Thursday. Japan will report consumer confidence numbers for February. Japan's consumer confidence index decreased to 29.6 in January, the weakest reading since August last year amid a resurgence of COVID-19 cases. Malaysia's central bank will announce its latest policy decision. It's expected to leave key interest rates steady as a slowdown in new COVID-19 infections and a recently launched vaccination drive boost confidence in the economy's recovery. And the U.S. will report its latest jobless claims. First-time filings for unemployment insurance drop to 730,000 for the week ended February 20, the lowest weekly figure since late November, despite severe winter storms that swept across Texas and other southern states. The Philippines expects to get its second delivery of COVID-19 vaccines, this time from the COVAX vaccine sharing facility. Presidential spokesperson Hadi Roque says 487,200 doses of AstraZeneca vaccines will arrive at around 7:30 this evening. He adds President Rodrigo Duterte will welcome the shipment in person. But Secretary Carlito Galvez, who's on top of the government's national vaccination drive, could not confirm the arrival of the shots. A Royal Dutch airline official meanwhile told ABS-CBN News nearly 500,000 AstraZeneca doses will be flown out of Amsterdam Airport Wednesday evening. The cargo is expected to arrive in Manila tonight. The World Health Organization says around 5 to 9 million doses of AstraZeneca's vaccine have been set aside for the Philippines under the COVAX initiative. The Philippine economy seen to grow 9.6% this year despite the delays in the government's vaccination program. That's according to the credit ratings firm S&P Global. But it flags high inflation and prolonged COVID-19 restrictions as key risks to the country's growth prospects. S&P Global says the Philippine government must at least ensure.
Currently seeing that does put a big dampener on the growth prospects of the economy. The other risk that could compound this would be currently the inflation. They are supply side in the sense that they're driven by food pretty much, and they are transitory, but they do weigh on the disposable income that is left for households to spend on other types of consumption at a time when things are already very difficult.
Philippine Trade Secretary Ramon Lopez, meanwhile, says there are already signs of economic recovery, with investments and manufacturing activities seeing an increase in the first 2 months of this year. He adds the start of the vaccination drive will help sustain that momentum.
The arrival of the vaccine and the immediate rollout of the vaccination program the following day certainly brought about heightened optimism in seeing the beginning of the end of COVID-19 pandemic, and will surely lead to greater business and consumer confidence on the road to recovery. As our economy recovers, we are confident of achieving our pre-pandemic growth rates and beyond. To this end, we are facilitating greater trade and investment in the country by continuously pursuing reforms to foster a better business environment.
The Philippine economy contracted 9.5% in 2020. That is the steepest drop on record due to the COVID-19 pandemic and the lockdown. For more on the vaccine rollout's impact on the economy, inflation expectations, and rising yields, ING Bank's Asia Pacific head Rob Cornell joins us live from Singapore. Hi, Rob. Good morning. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hi. Morning.
Okay, so let's begin with a vaccine rollout. The first batches of COVID-19 vaccines are here. Another batch, AstraZeneca, said to be arriving tonight. I mean, economically speaking, how long before this good news of the vaccine rollout kickoff trickles down to the real economy and gives Filipinos tangible economic relief?
Yes, well, firstly, I should point out that the Wi-Fi connection seems a bit flaky, so I hope you'll hear me.
We can.
Yeah, it's really it's gonna start working its through to the real economy once you've got enough of these vaccines out. You really do need to get a lot of people vaccinated before you're going to start seeing the numbers of daily cases falling, the death rates coming, and the ability then for the government to really start opening the economy. So it's early days. You know, the Philippines is one of the last countries in Asia to start. Hopefully it'll move along quickly, but there's still a backlog. The countries of the West, the US, the UK, the UAE, I mean, they've jumped the queue to some extent and are using most of the available vaccinations that are out there. And I think it's really only once they've done their populations and the vaccines start to feed their way over to Asia, that the Philippines will start to get its fair share and will be able to get its population vaccinated as fully as it can and see these numbers drop. Then, you know, people will go out, then they'll start spending and the economy will come through again. But until that happens, I think it's going to be quite slow going.
Mm-hmm. Slow going, but how many more months do you think can the Philippine economy take of this very strict and the longest lockdown in the world before the economy caves in?
Well, you know, I don't think it ever caves in, but it sort of limps along until this is happening. Yeah, and you know, in the end, this is a decision for the politicians. Do they sort of, as the vaccine starts to roll out, do they start gradually easing back on the restrictions. That would seem to be a reasonable prospect, but I think you'd need to see this reflected in the daily case numbers before those sorts of decisions were taken. And then there's a question, you know, do people immediately rush out and start spending? Is there a sort of pent-up revenge spending that people have talked about? And of course, much of the spending that hasn't happened is on things like experiences, you know, restaurant meals out, that sort of thing. It's difficult to double up on those if you think about it. You know, you don't have too many, you know, you don't have two foot massages in a day. That just doesn't make a lot of sense. So, you know, some of these things are lost and they've been lost forever. And it could be some time before the economy gets back to its pre-COVID state.
Huh. Okay. Okay. We're just going to have to wait for that. In the meantime, also happening this week, Rob, would be Philippine February inflation data coming out Friday morning. That's tomorrow. You know, we're coming from an overshot of 4.2% for January. That's above the 2 to 4% target range of the government. Could you very quickly give us a sense? I mean, we've always been talking about reflation and inflation, but what is the difference really between the two? And at what point do we say, okay, this is healthy? And when do we start getting worried about it? Or, you know, is it the way you view it? Is it in the eye of the beholder?
Yeah, I mean, there's an art to these things. It's not so much of a science. The reflation, inflation. Now, the reflation story is very much one about a return to growth. Mm-hmm. And that will bring with it a rise in price levels, and we'll see inflation numbers pick up. And that's perfectly healthy. You know, when central banks, BSP, start to worry about these things is when you start to see this filtering through into things like wage rises above a level that they think is sustainable and which they'll have to act against. Now, where there's still being a lot of people out of work in the Philippines, that's unlikely. There's a lot of slack in the labor market, which can be absorbed before we start to see rises above a sort of reasonable level. But, you know, this is a crazy year. Last year was completely bonkers. This year is equally crazy. The comparisons don't often make an awful lot of sense. We're going to see some really abnormally large numbers for things like growth, inflation this year, and we have to look through those to some extent, and central banks will be doing that. And as the previous speaker was talking about earlier, a lot of the inflation in the Philippines right now is coming from African swine fever.
It's hitting the pork prices.
You don't squeeze the the household sector even more by putting up interest rates to get rid of that. That will pass. You know, the thing about the pork farmers is pigs are remarkable animals. They repair themselves very quickly, if you know what I mean. So it doesn't take very long to start replenishing the herd, if that's the right term for pigs, once you start to move forward again. So this should be a temporary blip. Of course, we'll be keeping an eye on the inflation numbers, as will be BSP. But, you know, I don't think this is anything to be worried about. And we certainly don't expect any tightening action this year from them.
Oh, no tightening action. What about further cutting rates to help boost economic growth?
Yeah, again, that's not going to do a great deal of good. I mean, the arguments for cutting interest rates typically are things like, you know, increase liquidity, reduce lending rates from banks. And that hasn't actually really been happening. The banks are doing what they're doing. Interest rates haven't really come down that much from the banking sector. So further cuts in rates, unlikely to do much. And the same would apply for reserve rate requirements being cut. There's plenty of liquidity out there. It's just not doing a great deal. There isn't a demand for it. Mm-hmm. So you just create a further glut of sort of unused liquidity by doing this. And typically when you do that, there is a risk of creating asset bubbles where you don't really want them. So I don't think there's a great merit for doing that. You know, this isn't going to speed up the rate of the vaccine getting out, which is the ultimate handbrake on the economy at the moment. And it isn't going to do anything in terms of, changing the price level. So I think best left alone. I think that's what the BSP will be thinking right now as well.
Okay. And just for context for viewers out there, the BSP is expecting February inflation to be somewhere at 4.7%. That's a further acceleration. And they think it's going to keep rising until the third quarter of this year. And then hopefully by fourth quarter, all the way until first quarter of next year, inflation starts to normalize. Speaking of the central bank and rates, there's all the buzz around rising bond yields, Rob. I mean, what are the expectations that you have for bond yields, and what could these expectations mean? Is the trend upward the same across the board?
It is. You know, it's going up. Mm-hmm. And I think we have to remind ourselves that pre-COVID, US 10-year Treasury yields were hovering around 1.9%. we're not there yet. We're moving back into that sort of pre-COVID normal world. There's no reason to suspect that yields will remain, you know, again, crazily low forever. We're going back to normality. Now, mm-hmm. we can't, for some reason, we don't seem to be able to remember that far back. It's not that long ago. It's just over a year. But market seems to always be focused on what happened last week. So that move seems to be causing an awful lot of angst and anxiety, especially because it's been happening quite quickly. Mm-hmm. So it's been upsetting the equity market. We've had a few sell-offs. And we'll probably get more along the way, but they'll provide opportunities for people to come back in. And it's going to be a kind of two steps forward, one step back move, I would hope, rather than, you know, we get to our end year forecast of 2% 10-year treasuries in the next week. That would be rather upsetting. And I think mm-hmm. Jerome Powell, who's speaking tonight, would probably say something about that if that started to happen.
Okay. With regards to rising yields, central banks in Asia's emerging economies, do you think we've built enough buffers? Because we've added, what, $468 billion in Forex reserves last year. That is the most additional since 2013. Do you think this provides Asia with enough buffer against the recent jump in global bond yields? Or should we be preparing for tantrums? I remember what happened during the taper tantrum.
Yeah. I think for the moment it should be okay. And the thing about FX reserves is they're really quite helpful when you're worried about you've got a current account deficit, you're worried about your currency weakening. And that actually isn't where we are right now. The dollar, it's not really clear where it's going. A lot of people at the beginning of the year said it was going to be weaker. It hasn't really weakened a lot. And every now and again, when we get a big spike up in yields, mm-hmm. it strengthens a little bit. But, countries, currencies in Asia, peso has actually remained extremely stable. Some of the other currencies you might worry about in these circumstances would be the Indonesian rupiah, the Indian rupee. And again, they're holding up pretty well. And partly it's because the impact of the pandemic has been to really crush demand. So many of these countries mm-hmm. are actually running abnormal current account surpluses. They're actually looking in pretty good shape from an external perspective, and they've actually been holding it remarkably well. Where this might start to change is when we get to the point where the Fed actually starts to tighten mm-hmm. policy. Now, they've said they're not going to do anything with rates until 2024 at the earliest. I'm not sure about that. I think it might be a little early, and the market will probably push a view that it'll be earlier still. We've also got the concern about when they'll start to reduce the pace of their asset purchases, which they keep on saying they're either not thinking about, or it's going to be some time, or giving these really vague, not very helpful comments about that. And that's causing some unrest again in markets. So when that starts to move, I think perhaps we'll see a bit more concern in EM markets. But until then, I think we're okay.
Okay. Rob, finally, before we let you go from bond yields, let's go to commodities. Do you think we're underpricing the rising commodity prices from oil to metals? I mean, are you expecting them to stay elevated? Oil has been persistently above $60 a barrel. I mean, what headwinds or tailwinds can the Philippines, a country like the Philippines, expect from this trend?
Well, I think oil has a little bit of room to go further. We've got OPEC Plus meetings happening almost as we speak, probably later on today. We'll be trying to think what they need to do to get the market back into balance. So they'll be looking mm-hmm. to raise the price a little bit from here. We can see it going a little bit higher, and maybe getting, if we're using Brent as our benchmark, to something around $70 a barrel by the year end. But it's not a massive move from where we are now. It looks quite a big move looking back 12 months to where we've been. Mm-hmm. Likewise, other commodities, things like copper, are being pushed up by the reflation trade as well. People anticipating more construction. That goes into more wiring into buildings, more e-vehicles and electric motors requiring lots of copper wire and all that sort of stuff. So they are getting quite a lot of support. And some people are talking about a commodities super cycle. We're not really there yet. We don't really see a sort of 10-year cycle of increases here. They have gone quite a long way. They're probably not quite at the top, but there's probably not that much further for them to go.
Okay. On that note, Rob, thank you so much for your insights this morning. Always a pleasure to have you. Talking about 2020, that was a completely bonkers year, to an equally crazy 2021. Looking forward to what sort of conversations we're going to have for 2022. But until then, thank you so much for joining us.
You're welcome.
As you can see, we're now showing you live footage from Antipolo. This is for the vaccination launching ceremony happening at Antipolo Hospital. as it launches its vaccination drive. Testing Czar Secretary Vince Dizon, MMDA General Manager Jojo Garcia, and other officials from the Health Department are present at the venue. We'll try to bring you more details as soon as they come in. Now, after six straight days of over 2,000 new COVID-19 cases daily, the Philippines logged a slightly lower number of new coronavirus infections on Wednesday. 1,783 new infections were recorded, bringing the total number of cases in the country past 582,000. More than 35,000 of them are active cases. The health department also reporting 20 more fatalities and 330 additional recovered patients. But the day's tally does not include data from seven laboratories that failed to submit their results on time. Worldwide, coronavirus infections reached 115.1 million. Deaths have surpassed the 2.5 million mark, while recoveries stand at 65 million. The city of Valenzuela is set to open its cinemas and arcades starting this Friday in compliance with the national government's policy on the reopening of entertainment venues here in Metro Manila. Valenzuela Mayor Rex Gatchalian says the local government will rely on extensive contact tracing efforts to contain the spread of COVID-19, both from residents and visitors from other areas. He says Valenzuela already has a contact tracing app linked to the databases of three other Metro Manila cities. He plans to integrate databases with more LGUs.
No QR code, no entry in an establishment policy, meaning it's a law. You can lose your business permit if you don't do the scanning. So the burden is now with the establishment.
The Interior Department is still giving the option to local government units to require negative swab test results from travelers. That's after some local officials were against the waiving of the swab tests as a travel requirement. But Interior Undersecretary Epimako Dinsing also insists the new travel protocols announced recently are backed by science.
The science behind that proposal, the Department of Health and our resident epidemiologists were all consulted in this, and they were saying, one, what is important to be able to prevent and contain really the spread is the practice of the minimum public health standards by all everybody going out of their homes, and the travelers specifically. Again, to just repeat, face mask or wearing a face mask, face shields, sanitizing our hands, and social distancing are the main components of preventing or the containment of the spread of COVID-19. And they were saying it's 95% less risk or less chance of transmission or being infected of the virus.
Meanwhile, all national and local travel guidelines will soon be available to the public via the Department of Science and Technology's S-Pass app, which is launching in the coming days. Over in the U.S., President Joe Biden slams the governor of Texas for a sweeping rollback of coronavirus restrictions in the state. Biden says Greg Abbott's order to lift the mask mandate and to allow most businesses to reopen at full capacity next week is a big mistake. Governor Abbott has said he lifted the restrictions because Texas has administered nearly 5.7 million COVID-19 vaccine shots to its 29 million residents. A dozen other American states have no statewide mask requirement, despite repeated reminders from federal officials to continue observing health protocols. Up next, the PSE Index up for four straight days. Will that winning streak continue? Victor Limlingan of Regina Capital joins us for some perspective when Market Edge returns. We'll be right back.
have to be a working manager and a leader at the same time. Your team will only do as you do and not as you say. So it's very important to set the right example.
People who are in the leadership sector should be able to walk the talk. You cannot preach about sustainability without making sacrifices, small sacrifices in your lifestyle. That's the key. It will redound to the individual behavior of the people preaching and of the people actually following.
Authentic community. By focusing on that particular core value, a lot of these Gen Zs and millennials can be themselves. They don't have to pretend anymore. As we prioritize the voices and the feedback of our young,
Stock Exchange kicks off trading at 69.42. Joining us today for his take on the markets, Victor Limlingan of Regina Capital. Hi, Alvin. Good morning. Thanks so much for taking our call.
Of course, Mimi. Good morning.
Good morning. So the PSEI right now down by, let's see, 0.8%, 58 points. Mm-hmm. We're back 6884. What do you think?
Well, it's just the opening bell. Mm-hmm. We don't expect any dramatic movement. It's been up a few days, but we think it'll be range bound. Probably won't break above 7,100.
Mm-hmm. Is there a probably won't break below what number?
We think the floor is somewhere around 6,750, 6,800.
Okay, 6,750 to 6,800. Let's go to rising rates. Everybody's talking about, you know, rising rates. Do you worry at all, Alvin, about the pace that rates are rising? We've seen a global bond rout last week. It's sort of stabilizing mm-hmm. this week, but still, in mm-hmm. the bigger picture, is it a concern? Should it be a concern?
Yes, it is. Right now, okay, in the Philippine context at least, it's more of a cost push inflation. No? Mm-hmm. For numerous reasons, the price of food is going up. You just talk to anyone who goes to the grocery, pork is surging. Mm-hmm. Various other foodstuffs are surging. So that's a big concern because eventually labor will demand higher wages and we might lose a little competitiveness there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, when you talk about the rising bond yields, they're usually suggestive of economic optimism. Is that how the market is feeling at the moment?
No, I think at this point, it's more of anticipation of higher rates. Mm-hmm. When you have a normal yield curve, it does show that people think there'll be higher rates, but it also shows that there'll be increased economic activity. Mm-hmm. So they assume or they believe that the BSP or any central bank will raise rates in anticipation.
Are you assuming that the BSP will raise rates soon?
Not quite in the same manner as maybe the United States. There's a lag here. We don't have as much vaccines as they do. I think they'll reach herd immunity in May. We got our first batch, but I understand that was just a one-off donation.
Mm-hmm.
So there seems to be a lag in terms of when we will get our own herd immunity.
Okay, so because we're getting February inflation print tomorrow at 9, it's expected to top January's overshoot of 4.2%. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The BSP says it could hit 4.7%. Do you see this? Mm-hmm. What do you think? What do you think is the market pricing in?
Well, our house view is 4.8. If you look at the range, it's anywhere between, I think, 4.2 to 5.3 among the different houses. Mm-hmm. So we really do see higher inflation this time because of food. Our inflation basket is largely dependent on food. So these rising prices will find its way into the inflation data.
Mm-hmm.
However, perhaps the sort of analogous question is, what will that do for interest rates? We don't believe that the BSP will be forced to raise rates on this reason, maybe another reason, because you have this is referred to as what we call cost push inflation as for demand pull. Interest rates do not have that much effect on cost mm-hmm. pull factors. I mean, even if you raise rates, that's not gonna stop swine flu, that's not gonna stop coronavirus. You can only really have, interest rates are more effective when it's demand pull, when you want to curtail economic activity to prevent the economy from overeating, and that's just not the case here.
Okay, let's now go to the markets. Mm-hmm. in the U.S., the unloved sectors like hotels and airlines have started to pick up and overtake the once favorite stay-at-home stocks as vaccination accelerates and they continue to reopen. Are you advising we do the same here in the Philippine context now, or would you think it's still too early for that conversation?
Well, as you said earlier, it's rising because of the anticipation of mm-hmm. Herd immunity as the vaccination rolls out. But we're not seeing that program here. Mm-hmm. We do get reports of vaccines that may come by the first half and whatnot. But until we see sort of a definitive timetable of the vaccine coming, and bear in mind, it's going to be much more logistically challenging rolling out the vaccine here than it is over there. We think it's a little too early.
Oh, a little too early. Okay, let's now go over some interesting corporate stories that we have from this morning. This one, alert level one, has been raised over Mount Pinatubo volcano in Luzon. I remember this was a big story last year, January, even before this COVID happened. How do you think the market's going to take this news?
Well, right now, it doesn't really loom large, no? It remains to be seen how serious this is. Of course, if we have a massive eruption, that's going to be a really big deal. But as of now, nothing really points to it being that critical. Of course, we hope we don't have another cataclysmic event. That's sort of the last thing we need right now. But so far, nothing points to this being that serious yet. But that's not something you can plan for. It's a question of science. And so far, the science hasn't been that firm on what to expect on this.
Okay, so wait and see on this news. This one is good news for Now Corporation. Its affiliate, Now Telecom's frequency application, was just approved by the Anti-Red Tape Authority after they've submitted their requirements. This includes the assignment of 220 megahertz of frequencies, including 5G. Quick comment.
Yeah, that was a very interesting story. First of all, I was impressed that the ARTA was able to push the hand of a major agency on such a big issue. So kudos to them for cutting red tape. Now, of course, this is very significant for Now with these frequencies. They can enter the cellular and data phone business, but you know, this is just the first step in a very long journey. You have to roll out the infrastructure, understand they have some technology that mitigates it. But you have really entrenched players. You have the two incumbents, Smart and Globe, and you have Dito, which is backed by China Mobile. So Now we'll have to build the infrastructure and go up against these guys. So it's not clear to me where they'll get the funding, if they're going to affect the three players, as you will, and you know, what's their long-term plan after game. But it's a really big, good first step.
Good indeed, because investors are cheering the news. Now Corp shares right now jumping 22%, 3 pesos, 45 centavos a piece. How about this one? Not the very good news. The PSE suspends trading of Abra Mining shares, saying the issued shares exceeded listed shares. Can you help us make sense of that? What do you mean by the issued shares exceed listed shares? And by the way, Abra Mining, Alvin, I remember, was this loss-making mining company was the most traded stock in January. Even if it was loss-making, its share price doubled at that time, and now they're on trading suspension. But yeah, help us make sense of why the PSE had to suspend the trading of these shares. What does exceeding listed shares mean?
That's an unfortunate event. Now, I don't think this was planned or this was premeditated. Maybe there was some IT error somewhere. But basically, a corporation has a finite number of shares, but not all of these shares are listed. So some investors may choose to keep these shares unlisted. But for whatever reason, shares that were not supposed to be listed were traded. But I don't think this is something premeditated. I don't think this is, you know, something dastardly. There must have been some error here. I mean, there's really no, I mean, there's a process to list all of your shares. And, you know, probably some IT issue here. So it's very unfortunate, but yeah, it should be resolved soon enough.
Okay, we're just going to have to wait and see for developments in that news. How about this? This is from yesterday, but very interesting. Jollibee Foods says that its founding chairman, Tony Tan Caktiong, and his relatives, the founding owners as they're called, are consolidating their ownership under Hyperdynamic Corporation. I imagine this is part of estate planning to ensure...
Go ahead. Oh no, sorry. Yeah, that's what we were thinking. If you look at it, their effective ownership in Jollibee is not diminish or increase. Mm-hmm. So there's really no change in terms of the economics here. Mm-hmm. But as you said, it's probably estate planning. Maybe it's a sign that one generation will give way to the next. They've had such a long and illustrious career that maybe at this point they'd like to sit back a little and let the next generation carry a little bit more of the burden.
And encouraging to know, because even the next generation, I know some of them are also in the restaurant business, so mm-hmm. they've been dabbing, you know, their foot here and there with experience, so they're not totally going in cold feet. This one, Metro Pacific Investments yesterday reporting earnings were not that good, but they're saying here's the good news, that they're returning to pre-pandemic profitability by next year.
Actually, that's a very strong statement, and we welcome it, because essentially Metro Pacific is a bellwether of the economy as a whole. You have Meralco, you have their toll roads.
Yeah.
So if they think it's going to go back to normal, then it presupposes that economic activity will be back to normal, or at least near normal. Huh. Of course, they could also be reducing costs now, but it fundamentally says that economic activity must be approaching normal next year. So that's a very good sign. I mean, one way of looking at it is, if the United States reaches herd immunity by, call it, April or May, then that means they don't need to vaccinate as much, as supply of vaccines will be readily available
for the rest of us.
For the rest of us. So I think of it as like the new iPhone. No? The new iPhone comes out, there's a long line, everyone sleeps in front to get it. No? If you want to be first, fine, you do that. But then at a certain point, the queue shortens and everyone else gets their dose, no?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, hopefully by next year, the United States will be done. Maybe by the first half, it reaches here. We all get our turn, no? Mm-hmm. And the same story for other advanced European countries. After they vaccinate their populations, which is really their right to do so. You know, you can't blame them for prioritizing their own. Mm-hmm. And hopefully there'll be excess for the rest of us.
Okay, we're just going to have to wait our turn. Here's one, a foreign news. Samsung is releasing more details of its plans for a $17 billion chip facility in the U.S. We've been reporting about a global chip shortage, at some point even forcing many electronics and auto companies to shut down operations. Is this good news for our own chip makers? I mean, the likes of IMI or Cirtec?
Yeah, that's a good question. We were checking now. Most of their production prices are sort of locked in with contracts now. So in effect, they've hedged their production.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't think it moved the needle that significantly in either way. It's good that Samsung is building this giant plant. No, it's mind-boggling, $17 billion.
Mm-hmm.
If the shortage gets reversed, that means economic activity is starting to ramp up. No, to meet demand.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a good sign. But overall, when you have such massive supply coming in, that's definitely going to suppress prices. So when the contracts of IMI and Cirtec come up for negotiation, there might be some downward pressure there.
Okay. Alvin, we've come to the most exciting part of this conversation, your blind item. Talk to us about a stock that you're monitoring. I believe this is a stock that you like. Tell us why.
Yeah.
Don't tell us what this is. Just make us guess. So what do you have for us this morning? Why do you like this stock?
This is a stock. It's taken quite a beating lately. It's perceived that its core market has sort of withdrawn from the Philippines. So it's supposedly the most affected. But, you know, this company has diversified. They have other sources of revenue. As entertainment creeps back into the area, they're going to probably benefit. So we think it's more of it being oversold and undervalued. So, sometimes the contrarian approach is the best. No? You take a look at the stocks that everyone else doesn't think too highly of, and this is one of them.
Okay, we're just going to have to guess which stock this is. Alvin, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Looking forward to our next chat.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you. And time to zip through the top headlines from major business papers. From Business World, the number of super rich Filipinos is likely to grow over a 5-year period in line with a global trend. Real estate consultant Knight Frank says the number of high net worth individuals is expected to grow by 36% between 2020 and 2025. From Business Mirror, Labor Secretary Sylvester Belly III says the Philippine government could exempt the United Kingdom from its deployment cap for health care workers. And from the Wall Street Journal, Google plans to stop selling ads based on individuals browsing across multiple websites, a change that could hasten upheaval in the digital advertising industry. We're taking a quick break. Coming up, a former United Nations expert urges foreign companies to suspend all businesses in Myanmar as tensions over the military coup in the country escalate. Market Edge. We'll be right back.
Tapang niya. Kayo na yung iniwan. Pero kayo.
To be a working manager and a leader at the same time. Your team will only do as you do and not as you say. So it's very important to set the right example.
People who are in the leadership sector should be able to walk the talk. You cannot preach about sustainability without making sacrifices, small sacrifices in your lifestyle. That's the key. It will redound to the individual behavior of the people preaching and of the people actually following.
Authentic community by focusing on that particular core value. A lot of these Gen Zs and millennials can be themselves. They don't have to pretend anymore. As we prioritize the voices and the feedback of our young.
Welcome back. Myanmar sees its deadliest day yet since anti-coup protests in the country began. At least 38 people were killed on Wednesday when Myanmar security forces opened fire on demonstrators. Several others were hurt. The escalation comes a day after Myanmar's neighboring countries called for restraint and offered to help resolve the crisis.
We have now more than over 50 people died since the coup started, and many are wounded. Altogether, we have around 1,200 people are now detained, and many families don't know where their members of the families are detained, if they are healthy or not. So how can we watch this situation longer?
Myanmar's military seized power in a coup last February 1st and detained the country's elected leaders. The Philippine government calls on security forces in Myanmar to refrain from using excessive force against unarmed protesters. It also advises Filipinos in the country to avoid places of protest. As tensions in Myanmar escalate, a former United Nations expert says foreign firms should suspend all businesses there. Chris Sidoti says such a move will send a clear message to the military that its coup will hurt its people and ruin Myanmar's economy. Sidoti was part of a UN-led fact-finding mission which in 2019 urged foreign firms to cut business ties with Myanmar's military over human rights abuses. Sidoti says that position still rings true today and anything that enables the military should be avoided. Activists in Myanmar are also calling for sanctions on businesses linked to the military. And before we go, for those who tried to guess the blind item for today, this is a stock pick of Alvin Limlingan of Regina Capital, a stock that has taken a beating, perceived to have suffered from when one of its core markets withdrew from the Philippines. You'll have to guess which market that is. But the good news is this business has actually diversified and has other sources of revenues. This, according to him, is a case of being oversold and undervalued. This stock is DM Wenceslao, an ASEANA developer, and one of their core markets used to be the Pogo market. And that is it for Market Edge. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you for watching. Stay safe. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. For feedback, you can email us at ancfeedback@abs-cbn.com. Keep it here on ANC.
Kawani at mga kasama po natin sa Department of Health. Sa paniko, of course, ng Department of Health, apat po na Kawani from the Department of Health ang babakunahan po ngayon dito po sa Antipolo City Hospital System Annex 4. They are from Region 4, Calabarzon, Department of Health.
Better late than never. After more than a decade, Nissan has finally released the 370Z locally. This week on REV, we're driving the top-spec 370Z Nismo. Was it worth the wait or too little too late? Find out in this brand new episode of REV, only here on ANC.